Hello all. In this video series of end-to-end machine learning lifecycle, we are going to touch upon the data collection. I have divided this data collection into two parts. In the first part, we are going to talk about data architecture, various architecture and its relevancy to the machine learning or the artificial intelligence cycle. The second part, we are more going to talk about the data collection mechanism from multiple system of record. So let's get started. Now, if you're seeing this architecture, basically this is the end-to-end machine learning lifecycle architecture. The data collection part comes right after you understand your business need, your data need, and also your high-level non-functional requirement need. So this is the first technical step towards your machine learning lifecycle. Now, I'm not going to much talk about the architecture in this series, but coming into the details of it, this is your typical life cycle of your data, right? The ultimate goal of any enterprise or organization is to be action driven. Now, when you say action driven, it can be either opinion driven or it can be data driven. Now, both has its merits and demerits, but in this series, I'm going to focus more on the data driven action. Right now, in order for me to be action driven, I need to have insight about my business. And in the data driven initiative, the insights come with data. So data is basically our underlying knowledge on which our business operates on, or underlying knowledge in which our organization operates on. When I'm separating about business and operation, is basically I see business as a profit entity, and anything organization can be a non-profit entity or any entity over there. So if this is applicable to both typical profit entity and non-profit entity. So basically data is our underlying knowledge. And insight is understanding of our knowledge. So basically we have data. What we are doing is we are generating insights to understand our underlying business. And finally, using the understanding of the underlying business, we execute actions. Now, what are these actions? The actions can be anything that impacts your business. It can be a marketing initiative to personalize offers, or it can be an initiative to increase your top line, or it can be initiative to reduce your cost. It can be initiative to detect fraud in your business environment. So the action can be anything. This looks simple, right? But the challenge over there, in order for me to get to that action, to get to the insight, I have to collect data from these disparate source systems. That there will be an operational system which are typically database or file system, which are more like structured in nature, which is spread across the enterprise line of business. It's all over the enterprise. It's not in one single place. Right, this is only the structured information. I mean, a lot of unstructured data in form of voice call records, in the form of PDF files, in the form of basically emails and text and everything. So that is the second part of the challenge. The third part is I have a lot of external information. It can be the company social media page generating information for customer, or it can be an external data sources like data.gov, where they pull data to get weather information, or basically the market information, economic information, or something like that. Or it can be your partner website also, like the credit bureaus which the finance users, or even other partners that is relevant to the business. These three are there, and apart from that, it's like sources where you have high velocity streaming data. This can be your self-driving car, this can be your IoT. If you're in the manufacturing industry, basically all the machineries will have some embedded intelligence into that, which is continuously generating data to monitor the health of machinery. So that it can be your smart device, it can be your smartphones, which the customer is using. They may be using some of your apps as well. So basically the data is spread across multiple source system, and what happens is basically even you have an expert data scientist over here and you tell him that I have data all over the place, it's very difficult for him to generate any insights out of it. So the problem with the expert data scientist is basically his questions will be, how do I find my data? Right, the data is everywhere, right? He's going to spend rest of his life only just integrating the data if you just don't centralize the data here, right? And each data has its own format, your XML format, PDF format, the IoT will come in a JSON file, or your mainframe data over there. So it's multiple format, and it's very difficult for a data scientist to kind of spend more time on data integration rather than insight generation, right? And then other question, how do I pull the data, right? How do I centralize it? How can I make this data into insight-ready formats? Finally, what my model understands is numerical input. So how can I convert this multiple data formats, take it, collect it, and generate a model-ready file that my model can act on? So this is a pretty big challenge in any enterprise today. So one of the key foundations of data architecture over here is centralizing data assets within the enterprise. Right? We take all the data, centralize in a format, in a uniform format that a data scientist can consume. Right? That is the first part of it. Now, okay, I centralize my data. I also need to make sure I govern my data assets, because if I throw open my entire data sets, there may be a lot of customer sensitive information which everybody will get access to. So I need to make sure I need to govern and secure data assets and only give access to those who require it, not to everyone. Right? Now, that is the second part. The third part is I also need to catalog my data. Now I have like 5,000 source systems. I centralized all my data in a single place, 5,000 feeds. Now, how will my data scientist know which data resides and what are the definitions of the data? That's where I go and catalog my data. I create my technical metadata, business metadata, and also put operational metadata to it. Right? And finally, I organize, that is, create a common structure which is easily accessible, which is insight ready, at least insight ready, where a data scientist can work and do the future engineering and other stuff. The ultimate goal of the entire data architecture phase is to democratize data for everyone who has access to it in a secure and reliable format. To achieve this, basically, if you talk about data architecture, you might already know about it. I'm not going to go into the detail of it, but that is like the data warehouse of the world and the data lakes. Right, and these two are not a technology, these are a concept. Data warehouse is a concept. Now, there are technology that support data warehouse like Teradata, Exadata, Netezza, and all. Similarly, data lake is a concept where you can build a data lake on Hadoop file system, or you can build data lake on S3 or Google Cloud Storage or any other technology. Right, now the key differentiation between the data warehouse and data lake is how the data is organized. Right. Now, if you see the data warehouse, you have the same source systems I mentioned earlier. Now, when it comes to data warehouse, what you do is you basically take the data, you transform and then load it. So basically, when you're loading the data into data warehouse, the data is consumption ready already. Right? The data is transformed. You don't have track of the raw data at all, how the data looked like in the system of record. Basically, you have only a version of transformed data sets. Now, you can create raw data sets in EDW or the data warehouse. There is nothing wrong, only thing it's very expensive. And data warehouse does not have good processing mechanism to store unstructured data. You can store unstructured data, you can transform it and extract metadata and then store it. But just adding the raw data for further analysis and doing analysis with it, it's pretty difficult in a traditional enterprise data warehouse system. So when we talk about EDW, you can extract, transform and load it. So you have a consumption ready data set. Contrary, in the data lake, what we do is we just extract and load. So basically what we call in data warehouse is ETL, and in data lake we call ELT, extract, load, transform. So basically what we here do is maintain the data to as much close to the source system as possible. That is in a pretty much raw format. Right. So we take all the data, we collect it, we have the data as raw as possible. The only thing we additionally do is we convert the data into standardized format. So if I have a data in the mainframe COBOL format and in a JSON and CSV and XMLs and all, I will kind of give a structure to it. Either I can give a physical structure to it or logically structure it. I'm going to cover more on this in the next series, but just understand the data will be as raw as possible. Now, once you have this data, you can transform it as per your downstream requirement, as per your consumption requirement. It can be a BI reporting requirement, it can be an kind of a machine learning requirement, it can be advanced learning requirement. And one more aspect I forgot to mention, when I talk about action driven, your action will not be a machine learning at all. Your action can be advanced analytics, your action can be even rules. You are using the insights to generate the rules, you are either using insights to build your models. That's the difference, right? So having said that, the key difference between the data warehouse and the data lake is basically data warehouses a schema on write. So basically you define a schema and then you transform the data into the definition and populate it. It is very good for low interactive reporting. There is nothing like data warehouse or data lakes. Data lake is superior than data warehouse. It all depends on your requirement. Both has its purpose. So data warehouse is good for low latency interactive reporting. Dashboards are pretty fast compared to data lake. There are technologies supporting data lake that can make it fast, but again it's kind of adding more technology glue to it to make it work, right? And data warehouse is pretty good in high frequency updates. If you have a lot of updates coming in, then data warehouse can do it. Whereas data lake, you can do it, but you have to do a lot of work and you have to kind of batch your updates in such a way the updates are reflected into a file system, right? At the other end, data lake is schema on read. So what you do is you load the data as raw as possible. You can define schema on the raw data, or basically why we call schema on read is based on your consuming application need, you define schema to it and then you access it. It is pretty good for heavy lifting jobs like machine learning, advanced analytics, or data mining, or name it all. Like, it is also good with unstructured data, even though you have still structured it for insights, but still it is pretty good to store historical unstructured data and also archive it, which you can use it later. So this is about data architecture. In the second part, we will talk about we spoke about multiple source system. The source, the data may come in a batch, in real time, API based. We will talk about how we can collect the data and then use it into a machine learning model. Please subscribe to the channel AI Engineering if you want to get updates. Thank you very much.